dead.
You know, when I have a physical fossil, like what we've been studying for decades, right? It's an object, you know, and it's a three-dimensional object. And if I want to show it to you, you have to come to see me, or I have to make a physical model of it. And they're limited in the number we can do, right? However, with a CT scan, we now have a software model of it. We could see inside the bones. We could see inside the structures. We can model how they move relative to one another. We can compare fossils to living creatures in new ways. We can look at the shape of their bones. We can look at how the bones fit together like a giant jigsaw puzzle, say in the head or the fins or whatever. And we can compare those patterns to creatures both living and dead. And when we do that, what we find is sort of a powerful patterns in the fossil record and new ways of interpreting like how creatures moved, how they walked, using living creatures as analogs for how creatures, you know, functioned in the past. Okay, so this is a creature called Kikatania wakei. And we discovered it in the Canadian Arctic in 2004. And the first bits we saw were these scale fields. You can see these are scales of a critter. And we collected a jaw and so forth. But then saw something in this block right here. It was originally a block about this big, right about yay. And there was a piece of bone on it, which is right there. This right there is a piece of bone. So just grabbed this block and just took it, thinking, whatever, we can, you know, work on it back in the lab. And so we started to work on this creature, and we discovered that the front end of the skull here, which is right here, this is the front of the jaws and skull, looked a lot like Tiktaalik rosea. So this became a very, very interesting creature. You know, here's in the block. It's a tiny fin, it's about yay big, you know, between my thumb and forefinger. But when we've printed it out in three dimensions, what we've got is this. So here's the humerus, there's the radius, there's the ulna and other bones as well. So we can print it out at a larger scale and begin to see it work out in new ways. Yeah, what's really great about this technology is now, once you have a three-dimensional scan of the skeleton, then you can layer on the rest of the animal. You can layer on the flesh, you can layer on the muscles, you can begin to estimate how the bones moved relative to one another, how the thing walked, how it chewed, how it got about. You can make a living animal. And one of the nice things about the digital world is you can model out and trick out and play out certain assumptions in different ways. You know, and see, what's the implication of having more muscle on the hind limb versus the forelimb? And you can begin to test that. So it becomes its own little laboratory. You know, and importantly, it becomes a vehicle where we can now see and model these creatures as living forms, not just skeletons from, you know, 200 million years ago.
What the CT has helped us to do, which is a revolution, is to visualize those very tiny structures in digital format, and so we can really blow them up and we can literally enlarge them into the handheld size of the models, so we can understand the full variation, shape, size, distribution, variation among individuals of those anatomical features. And this is something we never dreamed of, and we're so happy to have now. Well, this is a 165 million years Jurassic mammal, and it's very old, and it's very tiny, and it is very complex in its own right. And under microscope, you can roughly make out here is a mandible. But under microscope, you can only see this fossil from one side of it. What about its three-dimensional structure? And we need to get to that in order to better understand its anatomy.
In the past, you never would have tried to remove it from the rock, right? It would have just been, this is all you would have had.
This is the best we can manage for such a small and fragile fossil. We get to expose it, we get to take a photograph. We used to be quite satisfied by it. To remove it, it would be next to impossible because the fossils are so tiny and it's so frail. If you move it out of its rock, it loses the support, it can disintegrate in no time. And we mostly prefer to leave it inside the rock. However, now we have the CT and we can see through the rock, and we can take the underside of the fossil visualized with digital technology.
My name is April Neander, and I've been working at the university for 10 years now. I'm a research specialist who does a lot of work with the CT lab. I manage the lab, I run the CT scanner, I train new users, but I am also a scientific illustrator for the Lowe lab, and I do illustrations for his publications. Some people might be familiar with medical CT. In a medical CT scanner, you stay stationary and the source and the panel rotate around you. But in this case, because it is an industrial scanner, the source and the panel stay still and the object rotates in the center. As it's taking X-ray images, as this object is rotating in the center, it gets to see it from multiple angles, and the reconstruction software is then able to calculate volumetrically what the density is of each voxel within that object.
The software that we use for segmentation is Materialized Mimics. It's used in hospitals for doing their CT scanning, and like, it's got, if you're working on like normal x-rays, like bones, people's bones, you can just click like two buttons and it's really smart. It'll like, you know, get the bone separated from the flesh and just like render it, and it's gorgeous and beautiful. And that does not work in fossils because we have such a wide range of density. Like, you can have weird mineral inclusions. You have to tell, you know, is this the bone? Is this a weird mineral thing? And every scan looks different.
CT data is just beautiful. Getting to see inside these specimens, all of these hidden pieces of anatomy, which is something I'm starting to explore with my personal art as well. It's fascinating. I could not have imagined I would be doing this as a kid. I was interested in biology and I was interested in art, so I kind of had an idea of scientific illustration, although I didn't find out that that was an actual field of work until I was in an undergrad. The CT kind of, I stumbled into it more or less, and I was in the right place at the right time.
There are drawers and drawers full of specimens of this fish and fishes like this, which are known from the Paleozoic. Hundreds, literally hundreds of species of these fish. And one of the big puzzles in vertebrate evolution is working out how these fossil fish relate to modern ray fin fishes, which account for half of living vertebrate biodiversity. This specimen over here, this key specimen of this fish here, is one that, you know, now I've been working on for on and off crumbs for, you know, 30 years or something. But every time we go back to it with improved technology, we keep finding more stuff. We can get into it that much deeper, and still we're kind of pushing at the boundaries. So it's this specimen that keeps on giving. We keep going back to it and saying, I wonder if we can find this in it. And yeah, we find traces of this, that, or the other in it. So this specimen turned out to have been described in a very rudimentary way back in about 1890. So I found references to it in the literature at that point, and I wrote it up. I did a bit of work on it and published a paper on it in the late 1990s. Because when we looked at, as I say, the part and the counterpart, one had a beautiful image of the from natural mold of the outside of the fish's head. And on the other side of it, there appeared to be something that looked pretty much like the fish's brain preserved, and the palate and the eyeball. So you've got all these sort of beautiful moldings of the interior of the fish's head. This is really unusual preservation. It's not unique, it happens elsewhere. So I was keen to get that properly imaged and described as best I could at the time. So that allowed me to come out with a new data set on, you know, some more insight into the, if you like, the paleobiology of this fish. But more recently, with the rise of CT scanning and new imaging methods, we've been able to return to this fish yet again
and find out more about what's on the interior of it without the risk of damaging the specimen.
Oh, I think CT scanning is like, is gonna change everything. It's already changed everything. It's gonna keep doing that. And as we get both better scanners as well as better software processing to like deal with different densities and how that can mess things up, I think that being able to see inside these 3D fossils is absolutely a game changer. Particularly with fishes, I think so many of these bones are really fragile. If you try to prep them out, they just crumble, they fall apart. You can't see any of that soft tissue. You can't see any of these really fine internal structures without destroying the entire specimen. And now you can just put it in a scanner, do a real careful scan, real careful segmentation. It's time consuming, but there's so much you can get out.
By understanding all these details on the anatomy, first of all, the anatomical data and the insights we're getting, not only about hard tissue, bones, teeth and stuff, but the insight that this kind of information gives us about soft tissues as well, we're getting a much better idea about how these fish fit into the tree of life. And that gives us, fundamentally, one of the big questions running in this lab is understanding the evolutionary roots of the modern vertebrate biodiversity.
It's kind of mind-blowing to me that I can like lead whole expeditions now inside the cabinets of my own laboratory. You know, I could find new fossils just by opening the cabinets and scanning the rocks that have been sitting inside my office for years. You know, so basically we now have a whole vista to discover. You know, we thought we had known everything by collecting the rocks and preparing them manually, but it turns out once we can scan inside them, we see whole new things that we didn't expect. You know, so it's really exciting. You know, I look at my collection in whole new ways.